Should be good.
Yep.
I think.
Are you going to be able to hear back there? Are you going to be able to hear us? He got me. now that we made it through that song, I couldn't hear anybody in the monitors that had vocals. Hello? I knew you were messing with stuff, so I just kept singing. I don't think so. I think it's all up there. Check, test, 1, 2, 3, 4. Can you guys hear me back there? Or is it bouncing out of? Check, test, 1, 2, 3, 4. That sounds better. I think so. Okay. Well, I can now. But nobody's playing. Chris, did you follow what we did there? Yeah. It was different on the than the slides were up there. Oh, the first time around? Interesting. Yes. Okay. Yeah, let's go to the next one since we...
Filling every part of our brain. glory. Show us your power. Show us your glory, Lord.
I thought that was pretty awesome. What? Monitors were better, yes. Could everybody else hear me in the back? In the back 40? Everything, or just...
It just seems like the knob that has power is turned down. Everything seems light. But this is my second week sitting here.
Yeah. I don't know how it is out there. It seems okay. Yeah. Yeah, that's good. Chorus as an intro, is that what you said?
Yeah.
Okay, cool.
Transport.
I think you can hear the vocals really good out there. I'm trying to figure out if it was the bass that was missing. I don't know. What's the bass set at overall? Is it still pretty high? Okay. It doesn't sound, it sounds pretty good. It just sounds different, and it could be because of where we're. Well, the vocalists are used to hearing drums right here, which is kind of, it's not? So maybe that's why it feels kind of hollow up here. Yeah, we might bring that up just a tad in these two if we can. I don't know if that. Can you play your keys again? See where they're at. Okay. I think it's good.
So is that song supposed to be a little more like that?
Which one?
That what I was
doing. The last one?
Yeah.
That's about right.
See?
I thought it was good.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So you actually drag it a little bit.
At the end.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
They probably didn't have drums in church when that one was when that one was first around. Give you chills.
Thank you.
us the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you.
We're missing a slide on the chorus. Cleansed and made.
nothing happened, and now I know He touched me and made me whole.
Should we do two choruses as we had it in the slides? Okay. Let's do two. Yeah. I cut it short for no reason. You want to go through it again?
I'm fine.
Are you sure?
I mean, I don't have.
Yeah, I mean, we've got time to run through it again. Something on the first, let's see. Then the hand of Jesus touched me. There's some chords there that I'm not hearing, but I don't know what it is. It just doesn't sound like I'm used to, but I don't know. Yes. As long as you both play the same thing. It is, yes. But it's really easy to sing, if that helps. Do you want to, would you feel more comfortable if we ran a verse and a chorus? You're good? Okay. Oh, okay. Takes a while though, because it's slower.
That's good. Actually, you want to put a little blank interlude slot for that one? Put that little instrumental there.
Got a little instrumental.
If you want. That'll be good.
Should be good. That's the one we were missing, right? Okay. Yep. Ending. I think it's good. At the end? I don't know.
Well, his notes are over here, so...
Chris.
Can you put, turn your eyes upon Jesus at the very end? Yeah. Just, I'm not sure if he's going to want us to do it, but just in case.
What is what? Otherwise, we'll bake it till we make it. Turn your eyes upon Jesus.
Probably verse one and chorus. It's always hard at the end too, because if nobody comes up.
You just tell them what you want to sing. They'll follow.
Yeah. I think you want to start with the chorus?
Yeah.
Start with the verse. I don't know.
Are you with
can leave verse 3 up there, Chris, and then if there's people praying, we can go ahead and sing 3 in chorus again. Chorus 1, chorus 3, chorus.
Seen anybody play a set of vibes? They play it with like double mallets in each hand. Right. With a xylophone. It was a marimba.
Really?
Yeah, it was a small, like a half of one.
Yeah.
It wasn't the full. No, this is, I just saw it on, at the Guitar Center.
Yeah.
And I used to go there all the time, so I just went, I want that. And I just took it home and I was playing with it. Yeah. Oh God, this is way back in the 70s. And I didn't realize the maintenance of those wooden bars.
Yeah.
They're all mahogany and they're all Yeah. You have to restrain them every once in a while.
Thank you.
Please stand with us and worship.
Thank you so much for the privilege of joining here together with this group of people, like-minded, seeking you. And we want to pray that today you would be known as our honored guest. So God, have your way among us, we pray, in the name of Jesus. And everyone said together, amen. Amen. God bless you. We want to just welcome you here among us at our worship service. And those that are watching us online, my name is Pastor Joe, and it's a delight for us to be together and to sing. We're going to continue in worship, but wanted to welcome the Lord and welcome you. God bless you.
Awaken. to see you. Open up the floodgates. Oh, mighty river flowing from your heart, filling every part of our praise. Show us your glory. Show us your power. Show us your glory, Lord. Show us your glory. Show us your power. Show us your glory, Lord.
Shadows are
seated.
This morning, in the way of announcements, today, after the morning worship service, the ushers are going to be prepared to give you the, I'll just show you what they look like. The Bible marks to remind you to pray for one of our students here. So there are those that are for the gentlemen to take, which are the boys. This happens to be Ben Cusick, which I'm going to be praying for. And it tells a little bit about the student, how old they are, their interests and such. So the ladies are going to be getting the girls. So we will have those available to you after the service. That way you can put those in your Bibles to remind you to daily pray for our students. And I think there's enough. The boys are going to be covered by three men, and the girls are going to be covered. There's more girls. They're going to be at least covered by two ladies of the church. So be sure to be faithful to pray for the student that you receive. This coming Wednesday, first of all, tonight is our 242 groups that meet in homes. We had 242 groups that met this morning. Tonight they're going to be meeting in homes at 4 o'clock. Also, our 242 group for the youth begin tonight. So parents, if you will drop your children off here, the young people, they're going to have some times of fellowship and games. They are also going to be meeting this Wednesday night, the youth, in the youth house, and they're going to be studying Jesus and the culture. So that's going to be an important topic for our young people. That's this Wednesday night at 6:30, while us as adults meet here in the sanctuary for our prayer meeting. On Tuesday, the 28th of September, the Joy Group will be meeting downstairs at 11:30. And then on Wednesday, October the 13th, is also going to be a Fields of Faith, which will be at 7:30. Our youth will be going and participating in that as well. And on Saturday, is it October the 23rd? I think it is. We're going to have the Larimore Hayride for the church family to be a part of that. More information will follow as well. One last announcement in the life of the youth. Parents, MYF is going to be November the 19th through the 21st. And so that's coming up. Wanted to get that kind of in your mind. We'll get some things to you in writing in regards to that. I think that wraps up our announcements. Thank you so much for your attention, and God bless you.
Holy, there is no one like you.
Father, that you loved us enough that you sent your Son into our world to experience all that we have experienced, to make his way through our messed up lives, to touch us. And not to just touch us to say, oh, how bad we are, but actually to touch us with the amazing love and grace and favor that he has brought to our lives. And that love and grace has touched us in such a way that it has changed us. And we rejoice in that today and give you thanks for that today, for the amazing touch of Jesus Christ. And we still need fresh touches, God, in our lives. We have people who are from our congregation that are struggling. They need a touch from you. There are challenges and oppositions that we're facing that we need divine intervention, a touch. And we ask for that by faith today. We also thank you for this service. It is marked with the trappings of worship. But God, we want to be touched from you and changed. And so we pray for that. We pray also for the ones that are watching us and joining us through our Facebook Live. We pray for them as well and for their needs. And we lift all of this up with thanksgiving and with praise. We offer this in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. God bless you, and you may be seated. It probably would just be a huge understatement to say that we've been through a rough 2 years. We've talked about this periodically on Wednesday nights, that in the last 2 years we've been introduced to things that we had never heard of before. We as a nation have gone through a pandemic. We're still not quite all the way through all of that. That has brought a lot of losses to us. We've gone through a really and still going through some racial tensions. Political unrest that is still not over. We've seen the landscape of morality totally fall even further than we would have ever imagined. And through it all, we as God's people must be reminded that our hope is not in our circumstances, but our hope is only in Jesus Christ. That He is the one that is the source of our joy. He is the one that spurs us, that encourages us, that leads us on when we've experienced a disappointment, when we've experienced a loss, when we've experienced something that has totally overwhelmed us. I'm going to play a gospel song. It's a gospel song because it's a testimony. A gospel song is one that says something to you. It doesn't say something to God. It says something to someone else. You know the song, most of you that grew up in church, He Keeps Me Singing. There's within my heart a melody, Jesus Whispers Sweet and Low. The chorus goes, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. It's about Him and that He fills our longings and that He causes us to sing in spite of everything going on around us as we move forward. It's an arrangement that's kind of got some strange rhythms, strange chords to bring a freshness to this. I hope I can do it. But may it minister to you, this song that you know, and may the words speak to you. He keeps me singing. It is time for Children's Church. Children, you are dismissed to go down to Kids Life to be a part of a ministry for you downstairs. Today we're still looking in the book of Hebrews. And what often happens in the Bible is what so often happens in our lives. How many of you remember when you were a child and you had to study for a spelling test? One of the ways that you would learn how to spell, particularly if you didn't have phonics, is that you would practice writing out the words. How many of you have ever written out your spelling words at least five times? It's called repetition. for me to play the piano, I have to go over and over and over and over and over and over. Same thing with the red case when they're in sports. It's over and over, the practice, though. This is also what's going on now in the scriptures, is that the writer of Hebrews continually brings to us this comparison of Jesus Christ and the Old Testament way of doing things. We're still looking at how Jesus Christ is a far better high priest, great high priest, than any other priest before, and including the one of Aaron, which was the first high priest after Moses. So we're going to continue reading. We're looking at Hebrews chapter 5, beginning with verse 1. Every high priest is selected from among men and is appointed to represent them in matters related to God, to offer gifts and sacrifices for sins. He is able to deal gently with those who are ignorant and are going astray, since he himself is subject to weaknesses. This is why he has to offer sacrifices for his own sins, as well as for the sins of the people. He's talking about that current Old Testament way of sacrificing. No one takes this honor upon himself. He must be called by God, just as Aaron, that's Moses' brother, was. So Christ also did not take upon himself the glory of becoming a high priest. But God said to him, "You are my son. Today I have become your father." That's from the book of Psalms. And in another place, this is also from the book of Genesis, "You are a priest forever in the order of Melchizedek." During the days of Jesus' life on earth, he offered up prayers and petitions with loud cries and tears to the one whom could save him from death. And he was heard because of his reverent submission. Although he was a son, he learned obedience from what he suffered. And once made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation for all who obey him, and was designated by God to be high priest in the order of Melchizedek. Will you pray with me? In a new dynamic way today, God, we need to understand the role, the office, the calling that you've placed on your Son, Jesus Christ, to be our high priest. You have evidently felt that it is vital for us to know this, since you have placed it in your word. That somehow this knowledge of what Jesus went through, what he experienced, would help us along life's way. So to that end, we pray that it will be accomplished today. In Jesus' name, amen. Nobody, say the word nobody, nobody should in the church assume any kind of role of ministry on their own. In other words, God is the one that calls people into any kind of ministry. Can we say amen? The Bible says in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 18, that God places the members of the body according to what pleases him. So if you're a 242 group leader, if you're serving in the youth ministry, if you're serving in the music ministry, if you're a pastor of a church, you should only be doing that as a call of God on your life. That one was really puny. That should be a call of God on your life. Now, if it's true that in order for us to serve in ministry, that we must have some sort of a calling, some sort of a divine assignment from God, it was most definitely true for priests in the Old Testament. It was definitely true for a high priest. They just couldn't assume that role on their own. The writer of Hebrews is reminding us of that, that no one takes that on of themselves. In fact, we've got three examples in the Old Testament when they tried to do that. You remember King Saul, the very first king of Israel. They go out and they whoop their enemies. And when they do that, they want to offer sacrifices to God, which is a fitting and proper thing to do. But King Saul got very impatient. How many of you have gotten impatient? Got impatient, waiting for Samuel to arrive to offer the sacrifices. The Bible says 7 days pass and Samuel hasn't come. And the men started getting restless. And the men started leaving. So Saul took it upon himself to offer the sacrifices. And guess what happened? He offered it, and like right when the last flame goes out, who arrives? Samuel. And Samuel says, "What in the world have you done? Because you have done this, God will not establish the kingdom with you." Korah, he was a rebellious guy who led a rebellion against Moses and Aaron. They were going to take over. They were going to be the leaders. They were going to take over the priests. God struck them dead. King Uzziah, he enters into the temple to offer incense, which is only for the high priest to do. And what does God do? He strikes him with leprosy. You just couldn't take this on your own. This was a divine assignment that God ordained for someone to be the priest. Now, God has called Aaron in the Old Testament to be the priest. Remember Aaron? He's the one that is the brother of Moses. He's the one that, you know, Moses at the burning bush said, "God, I can't talk. You've got the wrong man. I can't go to Pharaoh. I can't do this." So Aaron's going to be, this wasn't God's plan, but Aaron's going to go ahead and talk. That's the guy that God chooses to be the high priest, Aaron. Aaron becomes the high priest, and it's not something that he came up with. It was a calling, it was an assignment, it was an office. He was ordained to do that. Now, his main ministry was at the altar. He was to offer sacrifices of goats, of lambs, bull, their blood. He was to sacrifice. He was to be the one representing man to God and the go-between. He was to do that. And I think that's interesting that there was this sacrificial system that God established in the Old Testament. What does that tell you? It tells you that we were separated from God, that because of our sin, because of our rebelliousness, there was a breach, there was a break in our relationship with God. And God, through His grace, came up with this sacrificial system to pay for the atonement of sins. And so we find this here as he sets this up with Aaron in the Old Testament. Today, Jesus Christ is that person. You see, in the Old Testament, you had to have the right person do the right sacrifice in the right place at the right way. You just couldn't do it any old way you wanted to do it. Jesus Christ now has come, and He is the right person. He has offered it in the right way. He has offered it at the right time and in the right way. So Christ now has become that high, great high priest on our behalf, once and for all. Have you ever noticed that in the Old Testament, they had to keep doing what? They had to keep offering sacrifices over and over and over again. If you've ever read the Old Testament through, I have often wondered, how in the world did they kill that many animals constantly? The stench. I've thought that way. Over and over again. But Jesus has come on the scene and He's offered one sacrifice for all time. And we're going to find out now that because of who Christ is, He is greater than that of Aaron. It's very important. And you're going to think, well, what in the world does that have to do with me today? You're going to find out by the time we get done. The first thing that we find out about Jesus here is that Christ has a greater calling. He was not only called to be the high priest, he was called to be the sacrifice. He was not only called to be the one that would give himself up, he was also going to be the one that would administrate it. He was to do both. And we find this here in the life of Jesus. Christ did not appoint himself as high priest. God the Father did. This scripture, "You are my son, today I have become your father," does not have to do anything with Christmas. Doesn't have anything to do with Christmas at all. In fact, in the book of Acts, it has to do with Paul, the apostle, in Acts chapter 13, verses 33 to 34. Paul explains this, "You are my son, today I have become your father," does not mean Christ's birth, but rather Christ's resurrection from the dead. Not only was Christ the sacrifice, not only did he die, not only did he pay the atonement for our sins, but he was also then raised to new life, raised from the dead as our high priest. No one has ever done that before. So we find out here that Jesus Christ has a much greater calling than any other high priest. The difference here is he was resurrected. He offered himself. Aaron offered animals. But Christ, our great high priest, offered that of himself. Here's what we find. Aaron was appointed by God. Jesus Christ was appointed by God. Aaron was taken from among men. Jesus Christ was both fully God and fully man, sent from God. Aaron bore he bore the humanity of his fellow man. Christ bore also the humanity, but was without sin. Aaron knew man because he was a man. Christ knew man because he also was the creator of man. Aaron represented the needs of men before God. Christ represents the needs of man for all times. All times. Aaron was only to do that while he lived. Aaron was tempted, weak, and yielded to sin. Christ was tempted and yet was without sin. Christ has a greater calling. And this calling is forever. Christ is forever our high priest. No priest in the Old Testament could ever say that because of death. And when they would die, they would relinquish that up to someone else that would follow them. Forever is mentioned 6 times about Christ's priesthood, and it is so vital for us to know, because for him to be a priest forever, therefore, he can offer eternal salvation for us. That is not something that is temporary. That is not something for this life, but is also for this life and for the life to come, eternity. Christ has a greater calling. Next, Christ has a greater compassion. Christ has a greater compassion. You see, in the Old Testament, the priest would only deal with certain sins. God in the Old Testament, he would only forgive certain sins. He would forgive the sins that were committed in ignorance. You didn't really know that you were actually doing that. You didn't really have the intent to do it. Blatant, hard-handed sins, they were judged. There was no forgiveness. You commit adultery, there's no offering to offer for adultery. You're stoned. You're killed. So we find out here that there is this huge, great chasm here on what was actually accomplished by animals and what is actually now accomplished by Christ. That Christ has a greater compassion. The Old Testament, they could identify with the sinner. They could identify with their weakness, but only as one that was also therefore guilty. How many of you know that sometimes, most of the time, sinners lack compassion for other sinners? Sometimes the way that sin hardens our hearts, the way that sin makes us more judgmental, the way that sin makes us look at someone else, we can be just as guilty and be harsher on the person that's committing a less offense. You remember one of the high priests in the Old Testament, Eli? When Hannah, who could not have a child, when she comes to the temple to pray that God would give her a child, she is so wrought in her prayer that she's actually sobbing and so emotionally distraught that when the high priest saw her, Eli, he assumed and accused her of coming and being drunk. when he himself was not dealing with worse sins in his own life and in the lives of his two sons. David, you remember King David, when he goes off and he commits adultery with Bathsheba and he stages to have her husband murdered, and he lives like this for a year. And he's confronted by Nathan, the prophet. And when he tells the story of the rich man that takes the poor man's lamb, what does David do? He gets infuriated at that man in the story, when David is the man. So for us to think that we could have compassion from someone who is just as much a sinner as us is not necessarily true. In fact, the opposite is true. It is a saint of God that is living close to God, that is remembering what God has saved them from. They're living by God's grace a pure life. They are the ones that have much more compassion than a hypocrite would have. So this brings us to Jesus, who was without sin, who therefore then has compassion for us who are in sin and in its bondage. He sees that, and he looks not at us with judgment, but rather with compassion. How many of you are grateful for the compassion of Jesus Christ? The compassion. Christ has a much greater compassion. Jesus was perfect and therefore had compassion on us. Now, when it says here that he learned obedience, how does a son learn obedience? The way that anybody learns obedience, through the experiences of life. Through the experiences of life, Jesus lived his life here on earth totally in faith of the will of his heavenly Father. He lived by faith, which is the way that we're supposed to be living. Jesus, as God, did not need to learn anything, but as a son, he had to learn what you and I go through. How many of you have gone through some rough times, even this year? Yes. Christ had to come to learn. He didn't have to learn obedience. Him being God cannot disobey, but he had to learn the process of obedience. What you and I have to face, what you and I experience, Christ came to experience that, and therefore that makes him far above a regular priest. It makes him the great high priest. So we find that Christ had to learn what was involved with our obedience. Lastly, we find out here that Christ has a greater calling, Christ has a greater compassion, and Christ has a greater sacrifice. First, Jesus did not need a sacrifice for his own sin. Are you awake? Is there a pulse in the house, or am I that boring today? Christ did not have to offer a sin offering for his own sin. He committed no sin. He came as a pure, unblemished sacrifice, perfect in every way, which had to be offered to God. He comes and he is that for us. Second, he offered himself once and for all. In the Old Testament, as I said, animals had to be continually offered. Animal sacrifices could only cover certain sins, but they couldn't cleanse from sin. It is only the blood of Jesus that cleanses you and I from any sin. Jesus is able to save, keep, and strengthen us as his people. This is why we can come to Jesus. He knows exactly what we go through. I'm going to share with you a story. It's the first time I've ever shared this story ever in public. It's a story that happened 50 years ago, and it's a story that I really, in many, many, many ways, buried. Until this past year, some of you know I joined a men's Bible study, and it helped us, helped me, in understanding this great, amazing love of God. Between my fifth grade year and my sixth grade year, we moved. We moved from the little town of Mount Summit, 300 people, to the big metroplex called Newcastle. When I went to kindergarten through fifth grade, it was a small, small country school. I got along with everybody, and everybody got along with me, except I didn't do well in spelling and with my assignments. But when we left and went to Newcastle, the big school, on day one, my world changed. The kids were rough. This is sixth grade. From day one, I was made fun of. I found out things about me that I didn't even know. How many of you know what I'm talking about? The names that they would call you over and over and over again. There was no break. I had boys tell me things that I just was totally aghast at. All in making fun of me. Towards the end of the school year, one of the popular boys came to me privately and said, "Joe, after school today, I'm going to fight Bruce." Bruce is also a real popular guy. He's good looking, he's got charm, he has athletic ability. He is the man of the sixth grade, two classes. We had two sixth grade classes. By all means, he's the one. And this boy, Eddie, says, "I'm going to fight Bruce after school today. I need your help." Well, I thought, what? I mean, what am I going to do? I didn't say any of this. I'm thinking, what in the world am I going to do? And I didn't know really what to say. First of all, Eddie never ever really spoke to me except to make fun of me. I thought, well, okay, I'll show up. He said, "We're going to meet after school across the street at the corner house on the corner part, on the corner of the block in that front yard." I said, okay. I thought, maybe this is a way that I can get in their good graces. 3 o'clock comes. I leave the school. I see them over there at the corner parking lot, or the corner house in the front yard of this house. I get there, and there's probably 20 kids there, all from the sixth grade class. Somehow I work my way into the group, and the next thing I know, I'm in the inner wall of this circle. And in the middle of the circle is Eddie and Bruce. And they look at me, and they both start smiling. And they both start coming towards me. And it dawns on me, this is all a setup for the whole sixth grade class. I thought they were going to beat me up. I wish they had have. Instead, they wrestled me to the ground. Their whole aim and purpose was to de-pants me in front of the whole class. And they accomplished it. I remember fighting. I cannot tell you. Fighting with every ounce of my being to prevent it from happening. That somebody, I'm just telling you, that somebody would even go near that part of my body is unthinkable. And I remember they did get my pants down to my knees. I remember my white underwear showing. I don't know what else occurred. I just know I was humiliated. Nobody ever said one word to me about it. I never remembered anything. I finally mentioned it to my mother just this year. And she said to me, "I knew it. You have to know my mom. She can get mad pretty quick." I didn't remember her getting mad. She got so mad she went to the school, and the school answer was this: "Sorry, we can't do anything. It was off school property, and it was after school hours." My wife and I went to my 30th high school reunion in 2008. And who was there but Bruce? Now remember, I went to school the rest of seventh, all the way through high school, I went to school with him. I went up and shook hands with him. You know, it's funny how life has a way of knocking, and everybody now is a little bit more on equal level. You know, the jocks are no longer the jocks. The beauties are no longer the beauties. I mean, it was like completely wiped out. In fact, I looked more like a jock with my beautiful wife. I said, "Tracy, it's too bad, honey, you're not 9 months pregnant," as we walk in the door. Excuse me for saying that, but anyhow. Can you imagine me having a high priest that can't understand that? Can you? Can you imagine me bearing that, never discussing it? I shared it with Pastor Mark, who pastors Living Hope Church. He challenged me. He said, "Can you go back to that scene? Can you imagine Jesus in the circle? What's on his face? Can you?" You see, with me bearing that, I now have a high priest that knows what it means to be rejected, that knows what it means to be ridiculed, who knows what it means to be humiliated, who knows what it means to be attacked. Do you understand that? This is why it is crucial. I know that some of you are sitting there going, "Oh, this is yawning, this is boring." This is not boring, my friend. You've got to wrap your mind around what Christ has done and experienced for all of us to even a greater degree, so that he has learned, he has understood, he therefore has sympathy and compassion for us. What is it that you have gone through? It may be worse. The point of it is, Christ understands. He understands. You have a great high priest. Will you pray with me? Lord Jesus, it is proper for us to look at our life experiences, even the ones that we so desperately want to run away from. In fact, that's what we sometimes do. Sometimes we run away from them just to survive. We don't really know how to emotionally and relationally unpack some of the traumas and some of the things that have occurred. But you willingly stepped into all of it all to not just theorize about it, but to experience it, to identify, to know. And many of us in this room have had a lot of hurt, a lot of pain that we have best tried to forget. And your mercy upon our lives will bring healing and wholeness, because we are coming to the sympathizing Jesus Christ. We pray this in His name. And everyone said together, Amen. Brother Stuart is going to come and lead us. It's a great, come on up, guys. It's a great song of reminder that even though bad things may happen or we may experience loss, it is crucial for us to remember to turn our eyes upon Jesus Christ, to receive the healing and the grace. You may want to pray. Oh, that's our end here. It's for you to connect with God. If you'd like to pray here on the